So Ravi, what do you, Ravindra Pai, bring to the table as an entrepreneur?
Well, I think what I have really brought to the table is that, you know, the organization was very unorganized setup when I joined the business. So a lot of systems, processes, a lot of talent that I've brought into into the organization. Branding is something that was non-existent when I joined. So I think establishing the brand, making it fairly vibrant within our target audience. So these are some of the values that I've brought into the organization from the time I joined.
So how important was it for you to work in the infotech industry and then come in as a second generation entrepreneur here?
I wouldn't say so much the infotech industry. I mean, of course, it was a lot more organized as an industry, but I think the large company experience, gave me a lot of insights, especially in terms of what people look for in organizations, people management skills, processes, systems, how does a large sales function work? So these are some of the things that my work experience with these companies sort of taught me, which I've tried to implement in my in my own organization.
And switching industries from technology to real estate, was it possible to implement a lot of them?
Well, I mean, sales as a function, I think, is the same irrespective of which industry it is. I think people are the same in any organization. So many of these things, I think are sort of sector agnostic in that sense, So definitely there was a lot of value from my experience with these companies.
What success did you achieve there before you joined your own business?
Well, at Oracle, I had a really good stint, So I was handling sales for South and West as a region, selling to the government especially, which is hard. It's a longer gestation period, the sales cycles are much, it takes a lot more convincing, it's bureaucratic and things like that. So I was happy that I finished amongst the top sales executives, you could say, in the region in that year, prior to leaving. So it was quite satisfying.
So you left in a blaze of glory.
Yes, I was very happy with my stint there.
Tell us about the transition from land to built up property for Century as a brand.
I would say it's a natural progression, but having said that, people like to paint real estate industry with one brush. Whether it's land aggregation, whether it is brokerage, whether it is residential, commercial, different asset classes, we call it with the blanket real estate. But I think each aspect is very, very unique and different, and there are very, very specialized skills that are required for each of these things. So by land, we were really experts by then, we were already, I think, 30, 35 years into the industry, had great relationships, bought land at historical cost. So various trends, but development itself was a big challenge. Right from, identifying people, like I mentioned, making the brand visible. I mean, there was a lot of learning curve, I would say. It wasn't easy, but having said that, we started small, So we started with developments which were maybe 2 acres, 3 acres, so we didn't bite more than we could chew. And in the process, I would say that we learned a lot. And today, we're in a far, far better position than we were when we started.
So what were the challenges and how did you communicate that with your consumers?
I mean, challenges were many, one being a land entity, the culture was very, very different, so first the fight was internal. I mean, how do you really change the culture? How do you make it more customer facing, So we were really moving from a B2B sort of a setup to a B2C sort of a setup. So the first challenge really came internally, how do we bring new people in, fresh blood, who are sort of customer centric, who understand, relationship management and things like that. So that was one challenge. From a customer perspective, there were natural challenges because, they never heard of the brand. We didn't have a track record to show for as a developer. So there were obvious questions in terms of delivery, in terms of quality. Obviously, it's a large investment for many people. Of course, that we had an edge because people, at least in Bangalore, knew of father, knew of his reputation, So that was lesser of a challenge, I would say, but definitely in terms of, setting the right benchmarks for quality and delivery time frame. These were challenges that we initially faced.
So how did you and your father coexist as entrepreneurs? First generation, second generation, working together, land built up. How did you coexist?
I mean, I would say we're two different personalities, and we both have very different outlook to the way we look at business. I think it's a generation gap, but I think we bring unique skills to the table. I think, like I said, he's very, very good at identifying opportunities. He's got a very, very intuitive sense, to take the vision, I think that's something that he really brings to the table, whereas I'm a more implementer, I would say, I'm able to take that vision and really run with it, execute it well, maybe put the right sort of people behind it, set the right processes, systems, and ensure that the vision sort of turns to reality. So I think that's really, in a way, I would say that we've complemented each other well.
So like two sides of a coin.
I think so.
So Ravi, what has your legacy taught you and how are you taking that forward?
Well, I think it's too early to talk about legacy really in that sense, but I would like to think of my contribution as really building a sustainable brand you know, something that is admired by people, addressing a lot of maybe issues in terms of, you know, I mean, be it good quality homes, affordability, right locations, you know, I mean, these are some things that I want to be recognized for, you know, really bringing to the table.
Meaning you want to sync with the market trends, right?
Absolutely. I mean, really building to where the demand is, you know, I think it's important to give people what they want. Customers are also very evolved these days, you know, so I think trying to really understand that and building a brand that is really admired within our target audience.
In your journey from 2005 to 2018 in real estate, there have been peaks and troughs. What did you learn from them and how do you take that forward?
Well, my biggest learning has been patience. I think this industry, you need to demonstrate a lot of patience, you know what I mean? Especially, I think I was a decade younger back then, you know, a lot more aggressive, a lot more eager to make things happen fast. But what this has taught me is that you need to show a lot of patience and things really then pan out, you know. I was very fortunate that I entered the industry at a high. So when I got into the industry, you know, the Press Note 2 had just released, there's a lot of private equity money into the business, things were just getting organized, you know. So I would say I'm lucky that I saw the good before the bad, you know. So I mean, I feel that there's always hope and, you know, for better times ahead. So that's really been my, you know, maybe experience over the last 13-14 years.
So are you a hands-on developer? And do you meet consumers?
Well, I would say I'm a hands-on manager in the sense that I would like to know about the nitty-gritties. I mean, I tend to look at details. Having said that, I don't meet customers, and it's a conscious call, really. I mean, like I said, I mean, we're setting up an organization, you know, which can scale. There are managers who are responsible for their role, you know. For me, I mean, really, it is many issues need to be tackled at their level. And to be honest, we empower our employees a lot. And I mean, all of them are empowered to take decisions. They can make mistakes. I mean, as well as it is thought through, you know, we have no issues in people committing mistakes, you know. So, I mean, that's the sort of organization we're building. But having said that, I mean, as an organization, we're an extremely accessible organization. I mean, the customers can meet pretty much whoever they want. You know, I mean, we're a very, very open door culture. Mahesh runs a large part of the construction and he meets customers regularly. We get feedback. I mean, and I'm proud that, you know, I mean, in the last 10, 12 years of our construction, we don't have a single consumer complaint as of today. Because, you know, I mean, a large part of it is not because there are no issues, but a large part of it is that we meet with them and resolve the issues. And we try to nip it at the bud rather than it really becoming, you know, into something much larger.
So what you're saying is there are no pending complaints?
Complaints are natural, it keeps happening, but I'm saying we address it, we try to resolve it, we try to reason it with the customers many a time, you know. So I think customers really want that from you. I mean, they want an agony aunt, or they want somebody who listens to their issues and not really be sort of stonewalled, not knowing where to go. I think that's been something that we have sort of been good at addressing.
Ravi, as an entrepreneur, what is your risk-taking capacity?
I would say that today, I mean, as an entrepreneur, I take very calculated risk. You know, I mean, there's a responsibility of a large organization. There's a responsibility of so many people who are dependent on you. Of course, there are other stakeholders such as financial partners, customers. You know, so I think there's a huge amount of responsibility, you know, to take any sort of uncalculated risk. You know, so I think today the way I look at myself is to take calculated risks. Risks are important because growth comes with risk. You know, I mean, obviously without taking risks, you know, you're not going to get any success. So while we understand that, I think, you know, as an organization, we bounce ideas off, you know, I mean, the senior management. We take a lot of inputs before we take a risk. You know, so I mean, I would say that it's not just about me taking a decision. It's really sort of a decision that comes with a lot of interaction that happens within our senior management team.
So what is that success mantra that defines Ravindra Pai?
Success has really been that I do not procrastinate. You know, I mean, I'm very quick at taking decisions. You know, I try to understand the various risks, maybe various viewpoints, opinions, but eventually I like to take the decision and I take it very quickly. You know, I mean, I don't let things bleed in, you know, without any attention to it. So I think that has been really, to my mind, one of my key success. Of course, I mean, I would say I'm a very driven individual. You know, I don't need to be motivated. You know, I mean, I'm self-motivated, want to achieve things. You know, so I mean, these are attributes that I have. You know, but like I really said, I think for me the key is to understand, you know, various opinions, diverse viewpoints, and then come to a sort of a very calculated risk.
In a market where many developers have felt the financial stress and capital adequacy is an issue, Century has managed to raise capital, continues to raise capital, and you have finance has not been a problem with you. How did you manage this?
No, I wouldn't say finance has not been a problem. I think we've just been better at addressing it than most people. Two, three reasons. I would say one is we're a very highly asset-backed company. You know, I mean, thanks for, you know, I mean, the many years that father and uncle have put in aggregating the land, buying lands at historical cost. You know, so today we're a very, very asset-rich company. unlike most of the developers who rely on third-party landowners or joint developments, really where the asset is not there. So we're, you know, I mean, like I say, whatever our, you know, whatever be our loans and things like that are asset-backed. So that is one big advantage. Second, I think, is that deep partnership that we've built with financial institutions, you know, be it a Piramal or many other, you know, institutions, where it's been a very partnership approach. We're very transparent with them in terms of, you know, I mean, what the business is like. We make it a point to meet them every quarter to sort of update them, you know, and not really wait for bad news to be delivered, you know, I mean, or shock them in that sense. You know, so these have been some of the reasons we've been, I think, better at managing some of these issues.
Ravi, how have policy changes impacted you? We've seen so many policy changes in the last 1 year.
Well, I think from a policy perspective, there have really been three big policy changes, as you're aware. One has been the demonetization. I think that did impact the industry in some sense. We were lucky that our portfolio had a mix of plotted developments along with the apartments, you know. So the plotted sort of development projects kept us going through the demonetization phase. GST, of course, I think has not really been, I mean, that much of an, you know, I haven't seen that much of an impact. We all had to get adjusted to it, took some amount of time, but I think it was fine. RERA to me has really been the game changer for this industry. While I've been a big advocate that something like this is very, very essential for the industry to grow, to me I saw the biggest impact, you know, just about 2 weeks back when we did our first launch post RERA. My learning has been that typically, you know, I mean, what we would do is in our urgency to go to the market, we would always be a little bit early to the market. You know, either the presentation or the marketing office may not be fully ready. Just as we thought that the approvals would come through, you know, we would hit the market. But RERA forced us to really sort of make sure that we got everything together, you know, be it approvals, home loan, you know, I mean, clarity in terms of, you know, the plot layouts, the marketing office presentation. And this really helped us in two ways. One is velocity. We were able to sell 100 plots in just 2 weeks' time. And second, we got a much higher realization that we had sort of underwritten. You know, I mean, we were thinking at a price point of maybe 1,800 rupees a square foot, and we did a good 20% higher. You know, so both the velocity as well as price improved. And I think to me, that was a big sort of an insight that how RERA has contributed in, you know, sort of maybe getting us our act together.
Yeah, sure. And what is Century's contribution to the industry?
Well, I mean, as a company, we keep trying to raise the benchmark, you know, I mean, be it in terms of, you know, sort of customer relationship. We were talking a little while back about how the consumer is, and especially Bangalore being the IT sort of hub, are so used to today, you know, sort of maybe the Amazon or Flipkart sort of a purchase. People don't want to interact with people, you know, I mean, people are much happier sort of doing the research online, and, you know, I mean, I'm sure you better know this, you know, I mean, so how do we sort of as an industry evolve to that, you know, so that is something that we are constantly trying. In various ways, we try to keep upping the, you know, sort of benchmark, so to say, for the industry. The other big contribution has been really that we set up a real estate chair in IIM Bangalore, which is the first of its kind in India, primarily sort of doing research around where is data, you know, I mean, I think there's a lack of data in the industry when it comes to our sector, you know, so how do we sort of research that? So that's something that we've been instrumental in setting up.
Right. And so we have Ravindra Pai, an entrepreneur, a technology expert, a risk taker, a finance expert, and also somebody who believes that policy and structure helps the industry grow.